let us go on and see embedded optionality risk. This is one of the very important risk. It creates not only liquidity risk, it also creates an interest rate risk. We have a number of times discussed what is embedded optionality risk. We have to, let us think that, to again recapitulate, a bank accepts a 5-year deposit and thinks that the deposit will come only on the 5th year, either for renewing or taking money, but if nothing is mentioned in the fixed deposit, but after 1 month, surprisingly, the depositor comes back and asks for premature withdrawal of this deposit. Maximum bank cannot say, I will not pay this. The only control they got, they can say that I will not pay any interest, but the principal is to be repaid. This is called embedded optionality risk. It means the sudden premature withdrawal of term deposit creates a sudden cash outflow. Same way we have seen, housing loan is given for 10 years. Let us think that suddenly there is a cash inflow. It means nowadays all people are going abroad. They raise their earnings not in rupee, they raise their in dollars. It means it is 6 times when compared to rupee. So when they go, when the dollar inflow comes place, naturally all these long-term assets, housing loan or education loan, gets prematurely closed. So it creates a sudden inflow for the bank. They are left with, because they don't know, suddenly when the inflow comes, how to invest this in a long-term asset is a challenge for the bank. So this option of prepayment of loan or foreclosure of deposit before the stated maturity is constituted embedded option risk, or it's also called embedded optionality risk. Significant changes in market interest rate encourage borrowers to prepay their loans ahead of time, which I have explained, and exercise call or put options on bonds, debentures, and premature withdrawal of term deposits before the stated maturities. Particularly these call option, put options deposits are not there in Indian situation, but call options, yes, banks are allowed to issue IPDA bonds or upper tier 2 bonds or subordinated bonds under Basel II scenario. So in case of upper tier 2 bonds, there's a call option built in at 10th year. So 10th year, a fellow who has subscribed to the upper tier 2 bonds, he can say that I want money back. So this called call option. However, when migrating to Basel III, all these instruments will be phased out. The risk alters the cash flow of the bank to the maximum disadvantage and affect the bank's profitability. It means suddenly if this premature closure takes place, it creates a cash outflow. So for meeting that cash outflow, the bank has to sell the assets at a distress value. When they sell at a distress value, it creates a loss for the bank. When there's a loss, the profitability gets affected. The embedded option risk is becoming a reality in India and is experienced in high volatile conditions, situations. If volatility is very high, let us think that share market goes up, volatility, the returns are there, naturally people will try to close the term deposit, put their money in share market or the market which is doing well. Let us move on to next type of interest rate risk, which is called reinvestment risk. Reinvestment risk is nothing but on due date whether my depositor will renew this deposit or not. If he is withdrawing, then it creates a liquidity risk, or if he is reinvesting at higher rate of interest, it creates an interest rate risk. It means reinvestment leads to two kinds of risk. One is liquidity risk and is interest rate risk. To repeat once again, if he is not renewing and takes the money out, it creates a liquidity risk. Yes, he continued to with me, but he will renew at a higher rate of interest. It creates an interest rate risk. Uncertainty with regard to interest rate at which future cash flows could be reinvested is called reinvestment risk. At falling interest rate periods, the investor cannot reinvest at the same interest rate at which the earlier income was reinvested. It means when the interest rates are falling, it is always good for the bank, because on maturity date, he will be accepting the fresh deposit at a lower rate of interest. But when interest rates are going up, it creates a problem for the bank, because future deposits are accepted at a higher rate of interest. In these scenarios, zero coupon bonds are at an advantageous position as far as investors, since they are no in between cash flows and in these bonds. If you take zero in coupon bond, what is zero coupon bond? There is no intermittent cash flows available. Suppose they draw quarterly interest linked to floating rate of interest, then every 6 months or every 3 months, when the interest rate goes up, the bank has to pay more interest. Whereas in zero coupon bond, you accept the deposit today and you pay with interest only on due date. So such kind of thing, there is no interest rate is in between, because only one rate of interest called fixed interest rate, that is paid with principal and interest on due date only. In that, the interest rate risk is very less. The higher the coupon of a bond, higher the reinvestment risk run by the investors. Repricing risk, risk of adverse movement in interest rate on approaching repricing schedule in case of floating asset or liability product. This mostly arises in case of floating rate, advances and liabilities. Yes, reinvestment risk is more when assets and liabilities are linked to a benchmark, because let us think that a bank accepts a 5-year deposit linked to 91 days treasury bill. It means in a year, the deposit comes for repricing 4 times. It means in 5 years, this deposit comes for 20 times. Let us think that interest rate rising scenario, every 20 times, this deposit will be renewed, or the bank has to pay higher rate of interest. In measuring the IRR, we have to divide the assets into two types, the liability into two types. So in case of asset, the asset can be divided into risk sensitive assets and non-sensitive assets. Like that, the liability has to be divided risk sensitive liabilities, non-sensitive liability. Non-sensitive liabilities means there is no interest attached. Now let us go back. What is RSA or risk sensitive assets? All loans, investment where coupon is there. So whenever interest rate is there, it is called risk sensitive assets. Which are non-sensitive assets? Fixed assets, building, premises, cash on hand, bank balances, or balance parked with RBI for CRR, because the CRR portion, bank is not getting any interest. So such kind of placements or assets are called non-sensitive, because they are dead assets, or NPAs on which bank is not getting any interest. Then let us come to liabilities, which are risk sensitive liabilities, all deposits, term deposits, and borrowings, call money, repo, all these things are borrowings linked to a particular rate of interest to pay, including savings bank, even though it is less rate of interest. Nowadays, almost all banks, even though it is deregulated, almost all the banks pay 4%. On this, the non-sensitive liabilities, which are capital, there is no interest linked to that. Current deposit, absolutely banks don't pay any interest, or your bills payable items, which are all interbank adjustment items, on that there is. So before doing the interest rate measurement or managing the interest rate risk, the asset side and the liability side of the balance sheet, for the purpose of measuring the interest rate, it has to be divided into risk sensitive, non-sensitive, asset side and liability side. Let us think that how the asset sensitivity will be reduced, and also we'll see how the liability sensitivity will be reduced. Let us take for discussion strategies to be adopted for reducing the asset sensitivity. Extending the investment folio maturities, increase the floating rate deposits, increase the fixed rate lendings, offloading or selling the floating rate bonds, increasing the short term borrowings, increasing the long term lendings. These are the measures which will reduce the asset sensitivity. Now let us think how the asset sensitivity in liability can be reduced. Again, there are scenarios: reducing the investment portfolio maturities, increasing the floating rate lending, increasing the long-term deposit, increase short-term lendings, matching the long-term asset with non-interest bearing or less interest bearing, probably CASA, current account and savings account liabilities, matching repriceable asset, because CASA, particularly current account, we don't pay any interest, savings bank we pay less interest. matching repriceable asset with same repriceable liabilities. Here asset, the interest rate gets hedged automatically, it's called natural hedge. Improving the asset quality of the loans, because if you have got more performing loans, you get more income. If the performing loans turn into NPA, it loses its earnings. What is the effective control a bank should have for interest rate risk? Let us see. A strong control environment, an adequate process for identifying and evaluating the risk. Like liquidity, there should be a department to control this. We have seen most of the banks controlled liquidity risk through ALCO, and if you see the Asset Liability Management Committee controls interest rate risk also. Establishing the control activities such as policies, procedures, methodologies. Establishing MIS, nothing but Management Information System. Reviewing the policies. A policy, once come, it should not stand for 10 years or 5 years. It has to be at a maximum. It has to be reviewed every year or whenever the trigger takes place. Reviewing the policies and procedures periodically and bring value addition in the process. So when you go for reviewing, probably some mistakes are committed that should be removed and the value addition is to be done. It means over a period of time, the quality of the policy should keep on going up. Now move on. Sound interest rate risk management involves application of four basic elements. To manage IRR in a better manner, what are the basic elements? Four basic elements in management of assets, liabilities and off-balance sheet exposures. There are four. First is appropriate board and senior management oversight. It should not be given to the department and forget. The board and senior management should periodically review the interest rate risk management. Adequate risk management policies and procedure. There should be a policy. I have told policy means board mandated policy, and it should be reviewed every year or the trigger as shorter as possible. Appropriate risk measurement, monitoring and control functions, comprehensive internal control, independent audits. And again, this interest rate risk management should be subjected to audit. It can be internal audit or including an independent audit. It can be an external audit so that the pitfalls auditors can point out and that can be plugged, and while review takes place, all these value additions can be given in the policies. The market risk measurement framework is heavily dependent on quantitative measures of risk. The market risk measure seeks to capture variation in market value arising out of uncertainties associated with various risk elements. So again, we have seen comparing the liquidity risk, we have seen it can be measured through stock and flow approach. And here, how this interest rate risk can be measured. Again, this interest rate risk being part of market risk. So how this interest rate risk can be measured? The sensitivity. Under sensitivity, there are two measures available. One is called BPV. It's called basis point value change and duration. And the last one is called downside potential, whereas BPV and duration is applicable only for coupon yielding instruments or bonds, whereas downside potential is nothing but value at risk. It is equally applicable for all the instruments including equity and all that, whereas your basis point value change duration cannot be applied on equity because equities are not linked to any coupon. Now let us take for discussion. What is BPV? The BPV is also called DV01, delta value change 01. 01 is nothing but 0.01%, the change. BPV is a method that is used to measure interest rate risk or IRR. It is sometimes referred to as delta or DV01. It is often used to measure the interest rate risk associated with swap trading books, bond trading portfolios and money market books. This, I was told, 01 means 0.01%. This is the change in value due to 1 basis point. It means 100 basis point is 1%. 0.01% is 1 basis point. So this is the change in value due to 1 basis point change in market yield. This is used as a measure of risk. the higher the BPV, other higher the basis point value change of a bond, higher the risk associated with the bond. BP is not new. It has been used for years. In many financial institutions, it has been replaced and is used in conjunction with value at risk. It can be used independently, but the measurement nowadays are value at risk or VAR. And again, we have explained BPV. Let us see what BPV does. BPV tells you how much money your position will gain or lose for a 0.01% change, movement in a yield curve. It is therefore quantifies your interest rate risk for a small change in interest rate risk. It means small change means 8.56 to 8.57 or 8.54 to 8.53. It is 0.01% change. Now let us move on to next sensitivity measure. It's called as duration, very widely used nowadays. Duration is a measure of percentage change in economic value of a position that will occur given a small change in level of interest rate. This duration is used in combination. The duration categories are duration, modified duration and convexity. So, modified duration measure the change in the yield of the bond to the extent of 100 basis point. We have seen BPV measure the change to the extent of 1 basis point, whereas modified duration measure the change in the interest rate to the extent of 100 basis point. It reflects the timing and size of cash flows that occur before the instrument's contractual capacity. Duration is a measure widely used in investment business, though the concept of duration is applicable to all assets and liabilities where the interest rate risk is present. So duration cannot be used for equities. It can be used only for interest yielding securities. Duration is a weighted average measure of life of a bond where the time of receipt of cash flows is weighted by present value of the cash flows. Duration uses net present value method and weighted average method, and by which it finds out what is the weighted average age of that bond. Duration is also called as Macaulay duration, following the originator of the concept, Frederick Macaulay, who developed this concept in the year 1938. Duration is expressed in terms of years, whereas modified duration is expressed in terms of percentage. The longer the duration, greater the sensitivity of the bond price to the change in interest rate. The duration thus helps us to compare bonds with the different structures to find out which bond entails greatest interest rate risk. As told by you, a bond with a longer tenure, a bond with a shorter tenure, the interest rate risk will be high on the longer term bonds. Now we have seen what is risk sensitive asset, what is risk sensitive liability, what is basis point value change, what is duration, what is modified duration. From that, what we are going to arrive at? Based on this, bank can have the following strategies. From this, these are the tools used for measuring the interest rate risk. The sensitivity of the long-term bonds will be more than the sensitivity of the short-term bonds. So when interest rates are rising, whether the bank should accept long-term bond or short-term bond. When interest rates are falling, the bank should accept long-term bond or short-term bonds. Or the bank has got long-term bonds when interest rate is rising, whether they should continue the bond or they should exit the bond. When interest rates are falling, they have got short-term bonds, whether they should continue with that or exit. All these strategies are formed based on risk-sensitive asset, risk-sensitive liabilities, duration, modified duration and convexity. These are the tools that are used for measuring this IRR. The sensitivity of the long-term bond, once again, will be more than the sensitivity of the short-term bonds. When interest rates are going up, the revaluation of long-term bond will result in high loss. As I told, long-term bond carries more interest rate risk. When any revaluation, banks as per RBI, they are supposed to do the revaluation once in a quarter. They should use the FIMDA prices for revaluing this. So whenever long-term bonds are revalued, and in case loss arises, the loss will be high when compared to the short-term duration bonds. Hence, under circumstances, the duration of the bonds have to be reduced. When interest rates are going up, any revaluation let us think that a bank has got long term bond, short term bond. The loss on the long term bond will be more than the short term bond. So when a likely interest rate rising scenario comes, it is better for the bank to exit the long term bonds. Like that, when interest rates are coming down, the profit on the long term bond will be more when compared to the profit on the short term bonds. So under the circumstances, when interest rates are likely come down, continue with the long term bonds and exit the short term bonds so that the long term bonds will give you more profit. So when rates are coming down, the revaluation of long term duration will give more profit than the short duration bond, and hence under circumstances bonds duration have to be increased. Based on the interest rates going up and down, the impact of gaps in RSA and RSL can be summarized, and it can be given the next slide.